All right, today we're going to continue in our unit on the anti-naturalists. We're going to talk today about William Sidney Porter. Hopefully you've already read the story, The Gift of the Magi. So as we talk about it, you know what we're talking about. Let me just give you this reminder that you should have your major work status sheet turned in. So you can just take pictures of it, send that to me. You should also share with me your slideshow presentation so that I can see that as well. And then I can get those graded. So let's go ahead and talk about William Sidney Porter. You probably know him as O. Henry. If you remember, we read a story by him in seventh grade. If you can remember back to seventh grade, we read a story by him called After 20 Years. That was the one about the police officer. And he was supposed to be meeting a friend. And the friend ended up being a wanted criminal. And he couldn't arrest him himself. So he had a friend come and do that. I don't know if you remember that story, but so his pen name was O. Henry, and he became the most famous American pen name next to Mark Twain. So he was very well known, very popular during the beginning of the 20th century, not only by Americans, as you can see on the slides, he was also admired by the French, the English, and Russian readers. The Russians liked him so much that they actually issued a commemorative stamp in 1962 on the centennial of his birth. That's how much they enjoyed his stories. They liked his humor and his surprise endings. And that's kind of his trademark. That's the thing that he's remembered for, is the surprise ending. As you remember in the one we read in seventh grade, After 20 Years, very surprise ending there, The Gift of the Magi, surprise ending. He is known for that. So his humor, sense of humor, his compassion, surprise endings, all of these things make his work a contrast to the pessimism of the naturalist. That's why he's considered one of the anti-naturalists. He was born, his name was William Sidney Porter, born in 1862 in North Carolina. When he was 15, he left school, went to work with his uncle, who was a pharmacist, and he eventually became a licensed pharmacist himself. But because of some health problems that he had, he actually ended up moving from North Carolina to Texas. He lived on a cattle ranch for a couple years. Then he worked as a bookkeeper. You'll find that he did a lot of different things. He worked as a bookkeeper for a few years, got married, and he kind of lived off the generosity of friends. He would write, sketch, do those kinds of things. But after he got married, he settled down. For a while, he was a draftsman in the Texas land office. And then he ended up working at a bank. And he was a teller in the bank. But he was going to run into trouble with that. His wife became ill after she gave birth to a daughter. And then he had started publishing this paper. And after about a year, the paper failed. Then he was accused of stealing from the bank, of stealing bank funds. And so even though his friends posted bond for him and said, you know, that he was innocent and everything, a couple years later, some indictments were issued against him. So he then skipped bond and he fled the country. He went to Mexico, Honduras, South America for a while. And then he eventually did come back to Austin, Texas, but only when he found out that his wife was dying. So he came back. So after she died, sure enough, he was tried, found guilty, and then he was sentenced to 5 years in prison in Ohio. So while he was waiting for trial, he heard that his first story had been accepted for publication. And then during the next 3 years, he wrote more than a dozen stories. He was let out of prison early for good behavior. And by the time he got out of prison in 1901, he was a professional writer. His fame was growing. He moved to New York City and he changed his name, used the pseudonym O. Henry, which some people believe he got from one of the prison guards from when he was in prison, Orrin Henry is what they think. So anyways, editors started asking for his stories, and pretty soon he was just writing all the time, busily writing. He would do about an average of one story per week. A couple of things you need to remember about him. His first book you'll want to know is called Cabbages and Kings, and this was just a bunch of short stories that were just kind of loosely tied together. to resemble a novel, so remember that. Cabbages and Kings. His most famous work is called The 4 Million. And what that means, the 4 million, is indicating what the population of New York City was at the time. And so that's where he gets the number 4 million from. And then after those collections, he published a few more, but about a dozen more. So he was a very prolific writer. Unfortunately, the end of his life was pretty sad, even though after his first wife died, and then a few years later, he married his childhood sweetheart. That marriage also failed. And then he died at age 48, didn't have any close friends by that time. And one biographer said that he was a gentle, alienated, and lonely alcoholic. So even though he had this amazing success, published all of these stories, his life was a sad, bitter end. But his stories are not naturalistic, and you can see on the slide why we say so. Naturalism kind of limits their view of life to the darker side. He did not do that. He liked to show the lighter, happier side of life, as you will see, or hopefully you have seen as you read The Gift of the Magi. Naturalists also wanted to deal with the stark reality of life, what life was really like, showing how the universe is cold and indifferent and fate is just in control. But he liked to kind of lift the veil from stark reality and show the romance beneath it, which we definitely see him doing in The Gift of the Magi. We have this poor couple, they can't afford to buy each other presents. So very depressing, but he lifts that depressing veil for us as we see each of them sacrifice something that they loved to give something to someone that they loved. And so we see those positive human values coming out in this story, not portraying man as just this helpless animal living in an indifferent universe. We see a different side in that. So that's why we kind of list him, or he is listed under the anti-naturalist. So remember those things about him. Cabbages and Kings, his first book, The 4 Million. The Gift of the Magi, the story that I asked you to read, is taken from his collection of stories, The 4 Million. And in this story, he focuses most on plot. Developing the plot. It's not really a character study. We're not focusing on the characters. We're really focusing on the plot and what happens in the story. You do want to know the theme of the story. The theme of The Gift of the Magi is sacrificial love. I hope that you were able to pick up on the allusion in the title. The Gift of the Magi is, of course, speaking about the wise men when they were bringing gifts to Christ. And so we have that allusion there in the title. In this story. So as you read the story, you notice this young married couple, and they're too poor to get each other gifts, but they each sell something that is special to them in order to get something for the other. And only do we find out at the end how each of them had sold the thing that the other person was buying them something for. Like, she had cut her hair so that she could buy a chain for his watch. And then he had sold a watch so that he could buy a beautiful comb for her hair. So the ending is an example of what is called situational irony. Okay, situational irony. What is situational irony? That's when there is a contrast between what you would expect or what you would suppose to happen and what the reality is. So we have this situational irony. The double reversal of expectation. Each one of the characters sacrifices that which is necessary to the gift of the other one. And so we have this contradiction there, this situational irony. Another thing that you will want to be aware of and be able to discuss is how the ending of this story is different from one that a naturalist might write. If a true, pure naturalist had been writing the story, what would they have done differently at the ending? Okay, so in this story, right at the end of the story, Henry have the husband and the wife, they register shock at what has happened, but they kind of bounce back and are able to see the goodness in the situation, right? Instead of staying angry and wallowing in, you know, what was awful and terrible is going on, Jim just says, let's put these away for a while. And instead of being just angry and upset about, the naturalistic writer probably would have had them become very bitter and would show this pessimism of the meaningless of life and would have looked at it from that angle, but not O. Henry. Okay. So we see from the story that the character of a person determines their view of the world, and your view of the world determines how you're going to respond to specific incidents, right? So if you think the world is terrible and indifferent and everything, you're going to respond in the way that some of the authors did, like Stephen Crane and Jack London. But if you don't, then you can respond in the way that Porter did with his stories and the way they ended, so that they weren't this utter disappointment and pessimism. All right, so that kind of wraps up William Sidney Porter. And then we will continue with Fanny Crosby. You will get an assignment to read about Fanny Crosby and the pieces there. And then I will post a video discussing her as well. So I hope you guys are doing well and are able to enjoy this time at home and to keep up with your work. So I will talk to you again soon. Thank you.